Very good afternoon to all of you now present here. I am Minita Hazarika from the Department of Physics, Lakhimpur Girls College, North Lakhimpur, Assam. Dear participants, at the outset, I would like to welcome all the participants present here. The three-day webinar on recent aspects in physics. Today we have lecture 2 of the webinar. This international webinar is organized by Department of Physics, Lakhimpur Girls College. Dear participants, the world is now in the outbreak of COVID-19 pandemic. During this adverse situation, we all are away from our institutional teaching learning process. But technology give us this type of virtual platforms. In this virtual world, this is our humble effort to do something for you all. Now, I am going to introduce today's resource person, Dr. Kishore Barua, with a beautiful topic, concept of time, in front of you. Kishore Barua presently working as a technical officer in the Department of Physics, Tezpur University. Dr. Barua teaches optics, instrumentation, astronomy, and astrophysics, besides working as the in charge of technical group. He has developed the astronomical center at Tezpur University. Dr. Barua has installed a 14-inch reflector Cassegrain telescope along with a self-designed dome system, stellar spectrograph, a radio telescope, and many more astronomical instruments for the astronomical center. His research area is mostly on laser-based microscopy, nonlinear optics, and astronomy. He has developed a laser and many more developed a laser-based microscope during his PhD research work. He is the author of books as listed below: Jun Melir Luka Bhaku Khel, Surya Grahan, a popular science book in Assamese on solar eclipse, published by Assam Science, Technology and Environmental Council in 1995. Akash Aru Ami, a book in Assamese and Bengali based on astronomy, published by BJPJ in 2004. Sabda, the sound, about the sound pollution, published by Assam Science, Technology and Environment Council in 1994. Handbook of Telescope, published by Assam Science, Technology and Environment Council in September 2013. Then, Know Your Sky, published by Society for Socioeconomic Awareness and Environment Protect for Vigyan Prasar, Government of India, New Delhi. Book chapter of Azir Mahakash Khan, published by Assam Publication Board, Assam, in 2017, December. He has published several research papers in various international and national journals on his research findings, and he has been invited to several institutions in India and abroad for delivering talk on his research area. During last 5 years, he has visited more than 400 schools, colleges, and other institutions in and around Assam and any region, and delivered popular lectures on astronomy and related topics. Shown astronomical video and films, arranged sky observation program and workshop on astronomical instrument and telescope making. And he is the founder of Astronomy and Space Science Association, Assam, and Prakjyotish Amateur Astronomers Association, Guwahati. Dr. Barua is also life member and founder Society of Astronomy and Space Science Association India, vice president and pioneer member of Pragjyotish Amisar Astronomers Association India and member of Planetary Society USA, light member of Optical Society of India, and light member of Laser and Spectroscopy Society India, then light member of Assam Science Society India, Secretary Tezpur University Branch Assam Science Society, and light member of Instrument Society of India, then and light member of Assam Academy and Science. And so this is the introduction to our respected today's resource person. Welcome, sir, to our college and to this webinar, sir. And now I request our principal, sir, to inaugurate the session by saying a few words. Sir, over to you.
Thank you. A very good afternoon to all of you. On behalf of Lakhimpur Girls College family, I welcome you all to this webinar organized by Department of Physics, Lakhimpur Girls College. And this is the second lecture of this 3 days webinar, which will be delivered by Dr. Kishore Borua from Tezpur University. And his topic will be concept of time, Samayor Dharana. I think it will be a very interesting one, and all the participants will be benefited from this lecture. As I know, Dr. Borua is associating with this field for last several years. I offer my sincere thanks to Dr. Kishore Borua for accepting our request and for giving his valuable time with us despite of his heavy schedule. My thanks to Department of Physics for organizing this. And with these few words, I would like to declare this session open. Thank you.
Sir, over to you.
Yeah, may I start now? Thank you very much, Principal Lakhimpur Girls College, Head of the Department Physics, Lakhimpur Girls College, and all the faculty members for inviting me for this webinar talk. So I have decided to discuss on the concept of time because it is very interesting as well as important also. But the most important part is at this time during after lunch, people generally feel sleepy. So I decided to discuss on that, and it's basically a story like discussion. So I'll start with my PPT presentation. So the concept of time in various part of the globe, people spell the time differently. So not going, yeah. So in a certain part, it is called tis. In Hindi, it is called samay. Then in Latin, it is called tempus. Then in Pali, it is called kola or vela or samaya. On Portuguese, it is called tempo. And Tangan, it is called time, like this. So in both belag belag, they call belag belag namare ami samayor kotha tu kao. Because samayor kotha tu kao lagale manuhe belag belag dhoron loy. Etia samayor e dharona tu nu ki asota samay ki ami bahut samay ami kao je in some religions the concept of time is slightly they change differently, they say differently. For example, the Babylonians, ancient Greek, the Native America, Hinduism, then Inca, Mayan, for them, the time was like whole time, means it repeats from time to time. They like whole time boli koisile, the time to samay to repeat hoy. Eta samayor bisot, eta particular duration of bisot, samay ta repeat hoy. So it whole time boli koisile they like. আৰু এটা কনসেপ্ট আছে, এটো কয় লিনিয়াৰ টাইম। লিনিয়াৰ টাইমটো বেসিক্যালি ইসলামিক আৰু জুডো ক্রিস্টিয়ান বিলাকৰ আছিলে। তেওঁলোকে কৈছিলে যে দ্য টাইম ইজ লিনিয়াৰ, নেভাৰ কাম বেক এগেইন। So it goes linearly. The past is past, future is future, and it never meets the past and future and never come back again. So this is the linear time. So there are two concepts of time in ancient time. One is the cyclical time, followed by certain religions, and one is linear time, followed by certain religions. So interestingly, our Hindu time or dharana asile, concept of time, humayor dharana asile, Hindu dharana mote ami dekha pao, ei tolor sobikhanot ami dekhim, the Hindu dharana mote ami 1 second ami ataike horu buli janu, 1 second, Hindu dharma, Hindu mythology ase je humayor second or fraction loke mane bhabibo parisile, truti, renu, lava, likshaka. Our second or upper kini dahipile, you look at a oyon year, then day of Brahma, cycle of Brahma. And again, you look at Pariu Parisile, it is 2 to 10^-7. On a second or fraction or look at the Pariu Parisile, our cycle of Brahma maximum asile 10^22. Iman Bosor, Iman Asoyota, Iman Eta Dangor. মানে সিস্টেম এটা তেওঁলোকে হয়ও পাৰিছিলে যেটো আমি জেনেৰেলি কল্পনা কৰা টান এটা আমি কওঁ যে 1 বিলিয়ন 10 টু দি পাৱাৰ 9 আমাৰ দ্য ইউনিভাৰ্স কনৰ স্টার্ট দ্য ইউনিভাৰ্স দ্য এজ অফ দ্য ইউনিভাৰ্স ইজ অলমোষ্ট 13.7 বিলিয়ন ইয়াৰ্স সো অলমোষ্ট সামৱেৰ হিয়াৰ বাট দে কুড থিংক আপ টু 10 টু দি পাৱাৰ 22 আপ টু হিয়াৰ সো there may be some discrepancies or maybe some wrong information, but you just see the thinking process, the thinking capacity during that time. They could think up to 10^22 years, that much of time, or a fraction of seconds. So this is more important. So Hindu dharma, the Hindu civilization, that manu bilak, rishi muni bilak hai, my fraction of second like bhabio parisil aru ifale 10^22 years loike himan kini dharona koribo pora obostha tat asile khali eta bhul asile obose in Hindu civilization when they discuss about the time it's called kala time is it was called kala they thought that kala is born out of sun na kujor logote একেলগেই সময়ৰ সৃষ্টি হৈছিল এইটো সূৰ্য সিদ্ধান্তত আছে এই কথাখিনি ইউ উইল ফাইন্ড ইন সূৰ্য সিদ্ধান্ত যে কলা বৰ্ণ আউট অফ সান টাইম সময়টো আমাৰ সময়টো সূৰ্যৰ লগতেই জন্ম হৈছিলে কিন্তু কথা হৈছে কি আমি এতিয়া জানো যে সূৰ্যৰ জন্ম অলমষ্ট 4.5 বিলিয়ন ইয়াৰ্ছ এগো সেইটো এইকাৰণে শুদ্ধ নহয় বুলি আমি জানিব পাৰিছো কিন্তু ইউনিভাৰ্চৰ জন্ম হৈছিলে যে 13.7 অৰ 13.8 বিলিয়ন ইয়াৰ্ছ এগো সো ইউনিভাৰ্চৰ লগে লগে সময়ৰ ধাৰণা হয় আহা বুলি আমি ক'ব পাৰোঁ কিন্তু হিন্দু শাস্ত্ৰৰ মতে সূৰ্যৰ লগতেই কলাৰ সৃষ্টি হৈছিলে কিন্তু সূৰ্যৰ জন্ম বহুত আগৰ বুলি কোৱা হয় এতিয়া যেনেকৈ মই আগতে ক'লো যে এই ব্ৰহ্মাৰ যিটো চাৰ্কুল তেওঁলোকে ধৰি লৈছে যে ব্ৰহ্মাৰ এটা চাৰ্কুল কমপ্লিট হয় যেতিয়া এখন ইউনিভাৰ্চৰ কমপ্লিট হয় তাৰপিছত ইউনিভাৰ্চখনো ডেষ্ট্ৰয় হয় এজন নতুন ব্ৰহ্মাৰ সৃষ্টি হয় যে নিউ ব্ৰহ্মা ষ্টাৰ্টেড উইথ এ নিউ ইউনিভাৰ্চ সো দেট ৱাজ দ্য কনচেপ্ট সো নেক্সট গ্ৰীক মাইথলজিত গ্ৰীকবিলাকে তেওঁলোকৰ সময়টো বেলেগ ধৰণে এটা কনচেপ্ট লৈছিলে দেয়াৰ কনচেপ্ট অফ টাইম ৱাজ ডিফাৰেণ্ট দে কল ইট ক্ৰ'নোছ অৰ এণ্ড এ কাইৰোছ চ' ক্ৰ'নোছ হৈছে ইজ এ কোৱাণ্টিটেটিভ টাইম মিনছ ইউ কেন মেজাৰ এণ্ড কাইৰোছ ইজ কোৱালিটেটিভ মিনছ অপৰচুনিটি ৱেন দ্য অপৰচুনিটি কাম দেট ইজ কল কাইৰোছ এতিয়া ক্ৰ'নোছৰ পৰা আমি জানো যে ক্ৰ'নোছৰ পৰা আমি যে ক্ৰ'নলজিকেল আমি কওঁ sequential chronology chronometer then ami je chronic bemar kotha kon je bahut din ekel dhoroner bemar hoye gele it is called chronic disease so these all the terms the chrono the chronic disease chronology chronometer these terms are actually came from that chronos chronos is the in greek mythology it is referred to time which you can measure the time so one is chronos and one is kairos so kairos is the opportune the time opportune time and chronos is time which we can measure. So that was the concept in Greek mythology in 12th to 9th century BC. Then, when we discuss about the time, it comes in our mind, what is the length of the year we discuss, how we have decided the length of the year, how we have decided the length of a month, why there are 12 months in a year, then why there is 24 hours in a day, how we decide that the length of a day, I mean, din to length to me can I measure kuru, can I decide kuru isi. The din to kami kyo sobe isi kata bali kuru isi. Eta bosorat kyo barata maa chake. Ek kata bila, I see le, ditya, manu hai patham bos that they try to understand the length of the year because they go for cultivation. Ditya kheti bati kuru isi le, manu hai arambo kuru isi le, azi para prai, 20 lakh bosor agor prai kheti bati arambo kuru isi le. Ditya manu bila kar ritu pori bortan. The seasonal sense was very important to understand. So to understand the seasonal sense, মানুহক ঋতু পৰিৱৰ্তনৰ কথা জানিব লাগিছিলে কাৰণ বেলেগ বেলেগ খেতি কৰিব বেলেগ বেলেগ ঋতুৰ সময়ত গতিকে মানুহে এখন কেলেণ্ডাৰ বনাবৰ কাৰণে খুব চেষ্টা কৰিছিলে দে ট্ৰাই টু ডেভেলপ এ কেলেণ্ডাৰ আৰু কেলেণ্ডাৰ বনাবলৈ তেওঁলোকে আটাইতকৈ ইজি ৱেটো আছিলে যে ৰাতিৰ আকাশত দেখা চন্দ্ৰটো চন্দ্ৰ কলাবিলাকৰ চেঞ্জ হয় দেয়াৰ আৰ চেঞ্জেছ অফ দ্য শেপ অফ দ্য মুন উইচ ইজ কল্ড ক্ৰিছেণ্ট মুন টু ফুল মুন এণ্ড ইট ৰিপিটছ চ' এই ৰিপিটেশ্যনৰ পৰা তেওঁলোকে কেলেণ্ডাৰ বনাব চেষ্টা কৰিছিলে আৰু এনেকুৱা এখন কেলেণ্ডাৰ পোৱা গৈছে পিঅ'লিথিক এজৰ প্ৰায় 6000 ইয়াৰ্ছ এগো পুৰণা এখন কেলেণ্ডাৰ এখন মুন বেছ কেলেণ্ডাৰ এখন পোৱা গৈছে চ' এই কেলেণ্ডাৰখন বনাইছিলে চ' মেচপটমিয়া এণ্ড মায়া চিভিলাইজেশ্যনত এনেকুৱা ধৰণৰ কেলেণ্ডাৰ কিছুমান পোৱা যায় য'ত তেওঁলোকে 18 মান্থ ইন এ ইয়াৰ আৰু 20 ডেইজ অফ এ মান্থ তেওঁলোকে কৰি পেলাই কেলেণ্ডাৰবিলাক বনাইছিলে এণ্ড দ্য কেলেণ্ডাৰ নেম কেম ফ্ৰম দ্য কেলেজ কেলেজ is the word, the main word from where the name calendar came. In Roman calendar and all these things, it came like this. So now what, why there are 7 days in a week? Ek kotha tu eta asile je eta week, eta 90 noy. There are only two parameter. One is the length of the year, it is scientific and astronomical. And another is the length of the total length of the day, one particular day, is a scientific and astronomical. The rest is not astronomical, it is just mythological, is a concept came from the mythology, ancient mythology. So, eta haptah tomar 7 din thakibo, etu Babylonian hole teoluke thik korisile je planetary bodies jobra korisile, teoluke bahut bostu planetary body boli koisile, jene Sunday, it came from the sun. Then Monday come from the moon, then Tuesday it was the war of God for Romans. For Romans it is the war of God. Then Wednesday is a Tyre, it's from the Odin, it's a supreme deity. Then Thursday came from Thor, it's a god of thunder. Then Friday came from the Frigga, the wife of Odin, and it's a god of love and beauty. Then the Saturday came from the Saturn, the ancient Roman god of fun and feast. So these all the name of each day came from the Roman gods. The prottek tu dinor Roman god or pra isile amar Hindu astro jitu hom mangal bhuth brihaspati shukra shani dev ba robi egetau amar graha bilak logote moon aru sun agor dinot moon aru sun ok graha boli koisile ei graha ketar namere koa hoisile. So the name of the all the name of our days came from that concept. Yare kono scientific kintu concept ba value nai ba kono astronomical kothar pura ei nam keta ana ekta mythological just for myth it has come like this. Then why there are 24 hours in a day? Eta dinot kyo 24 ghonta thake ei kotha tu ami eta dangor kotha karon agote agor manuhe bilake10 hour or 20 hour or 30 hour like this, why it is specifically 24 hours. So that concept came from ancient Egypt. In Egyptian, they call it is 24 hours in a day, and the 1 hour, they call it Hora. Actually, that Hora came from the Egyptian sky god Horus. From the Horus, it has come, the name came Hora, and from the Hora, we understand the name came hour. That hour actually come from the Hora. Basically, initially, they divided the whole day, the length of a day, into 10 hours because they could measure the fingers of your hand of a particular person, the fingers having the 5 fingers in the hand and 10 fingers in 2 hands, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So there are 10 fingers that they could easily measure the 10. So actually their day length were 10. And they divided the whole sky into 10 divisions when the sun rises from the east and it sets in the west. So that was 10. But when they observed that the whole sky is become bright even before rising the sun and for some time and after setting the sun, the sky is become bright for some time. So they take two different hours. One is just before rising and one is after rising. So they add this another 2 hours and it become 10 plus 2, 12 hours in a particular day length. Similarly, the night length also they consider 12 hours. So that 12 plus 12 become 24 hours. And this 1 hour they call Hora because they put it in the name from the sky god Horus. So from that Hora, the hour name hour came. Now, if you see how they have divided, if you see the sky, you will see some stars like this. In the sky, you will see a lot of stars at night. Now, they imagine the whole sky with certain species like some people, some men, then some animals, then the fish like this. So they call it's decans. The one particular area, now we call it constellations, they call it decans. And one decan, during that time, the one decan, it consists of 36 numbers of stars. So 36 of numbers of stars called one decan. So they divided the whole sky into 36 groups called decan. So 36 decans. And one decan, it roses the and it takes 40 minutes for the next decan to come. So after one decan, after 40 minutes, the next decan comes. So they could not measure the 40 minutes directly, but they could measure the movement of the particular decan in the sky. Now, interestingly, these decans, so that even the dead person can also see the calendar to understand what is the date going on. So that is what their concept. And this decan is actually found inside a coffin, this decan. So this is about the concept of decan, how the 24 hour came into the consideration of one particular a length of a day, a total day. But we know that when the Earth rotates around its own axis, it takes 24 hours. Actually, that is the time period taken, and we divided into 24 hours because ancient civilization there in from Egypt, they consider there are 24 hours. Now, even Egyptian up to 14th century, we understand that during the summer season, the day length is more. And night time is less. And during winter, night length is more, day length is small. Sorry. So from the Egyptian to 14th century, people actually taken this daytime, the hour time, it was longer. And during winter, the daytimes were short, but the night times were long. So because they could measure the day length, and directly they divided it into 24. So 1 hour was longer during the summer, but 1 hour was shorter during winter. It was going on for a long period up to 14th century. Even Hipparchus, you know that he was a Greek astronomer. So in 147 BC, so he proposed the division of a day in equinoctial hour, means in equal part. But no one considered his idea, and it was taken that the day length will be longer and night length will be shorter during summer, and day length will be shorter, night length will be longer, hour will be longer during winter. So it was going on for a long period of time. And the length where the hours were measured with the sundial, ancient sundial, and some water clock. Unless the mechanical clock was developed by Richard Willingford in 1209 during 1330. So that is what he developed, and from that actually the hour length were fixed. Now in ancient, why again the question comes in our mind, why 1 minute, we know that the 24 hour is now the one day is divided into 24 hour. Now why 24 hour was divided into 60 minutes, or 60 minutes divided into 60 seconds? So that is another concept. It has came from actually ancient Babylonian. Babylonian, they were very much used to the sexagesimal or the base 60 system. In base 60 system, it was actually borrowed from Sumerian. So in Sumerian, actually they were very much used to 60, because 60 is a digit where you can divide it by the smallest number, maximum smallest number, like you can divide by 1, you can divide by 2, you can divide by 3, you can divide by 4, you can divide by 5, and you can divide by 6. So that is why they were very much interested in taking 60 for that, and they considered the 60 and 1, and they could also measure the division of a day up to 360 part of them. So one part of the 360th part is called Ush. So from that, the concept of minute, and 60 minute is equal to 1 hour, they have it came. So it is came from the Babylonian about the 60 minutes in a particular hour, and 60 minutes from 50 second in 1 minute. So that came from early 3500 BC, so from Sumerian. Now, next question comes, why does the February only have 28 days? The rest is 20, 30 days, 31 days like this, but the February is only 28 days. These are all story actually. You know, and Romulus, he was a Roman, the first Roman king, Romulus. Initially, because of the moon-based calendar, if you see the moon-based calendar, 29 days moon circle. So in a year, if you consider the 12 lunar month, means 12 numbers of full moon or new moon, then it will come up to 354 days. So taking into that consideration, that you know, 30 days like this, so they measure up to 10, because they could measure 10 very easily, 10, and rest of the time they didn't measure anything. They enjoyed life. These are the time for the cultivation and some other work, and rest of the time they just enjoy their life. So that was their concept with 10 months in a year. Secondly, the Numa Pompilius, he was the second king of the Roman in Rome. So he come with the 298 days because he believed that even numbers are bad for him. That 30, these are even numbers, are bad for him. So he reduced one from each even number and he make it 29 in each even number months and make a calendar like this, 31, 29, 31, 29, like this. So it was compilious. So he made this with 298 days in a year. But we know that the lunar month cycle is 354. So rest of the days again, it has gone. But later on, when people realize that this is that way they cannot go, they put two more months. One is the Januarius and one Februarius with the god, name of the god. The Januarius, they put 29 days and Februarius 28 days to make it 354 days in a lunar cycle. So make a calendar with this. So here the 28 in February came. Now, after that, Julius Caesar, in that calendar was used for several years, several hundred years, in fact. Then Julius Caesar in 45 BC, he made a calendar with Julian calendar with certain gods and some of his interesting names with that. The January came from the Janus month. He made it 31 days. February, he kept it like 28 days. Then Mars from the Mars, April from the April days, May from the Maria's month, like this July for the Julius Caesar month. So he made a calendar with January, February up to December with 365 days. During his time, it was very difficult to understand that the whole year consists of not exactly 365 days, but it is slightly more than 365 days. So he made a calendar with that, but he didn't mention about the intercalation, means if you consider the lunar month and the solar month, then there will be a lag of time that we have to adjust. So he did not calculate it. And these calendars were used for several now. For several years. During that time, the concept of zero was not there. So because of that, when the Jesus Christ born, we call it the after that it is called BCE, before common era, or after before Jesus Christ, it is BC, and AD is stand for Anno Domini, the year of Lord. In the year of Lord, where the Jesus Christ born. Now, with this concept, actually, we should see that the Jesus Christ born, now, today is, we are having 2020, means Jesus Christ should born 2020 years ago. But it is not exactly true. Because during that time, the concept of zero was not there. So they didn't use zero. So 1 AD to 1 BC, there was no zero in between. So it was left like this. Very interestingly, Brahmagupta, Indian, Indian astronomer, actually he was a scholar and mathematician, basically, Brahmagupta, he introduced zero, the idea of zero in Europe and other medieval Christian Europe and some other civilizations in 11th to 13th centuries. In AD 600, it was spreaded, but the zero was published in AD 628 by Brahmagupta. So from that, the concept of zero was introduced in calculating the years in the calendar, and the years start from the zero. But if you just calculate the Zarathustra, he didn't born in zero, year zero. It should be somewhere 3 or 4 BC before Christ. So that was the time left because in Julian calendar, that intercalation with 365 was taken without intercalation means slightly more than 365, it was not calculated. So that problem was first detected in the by the Pope Gregory 13 and one mathematician. So he first introduced suggested Gregory that Pope Gregory that your calendar is missing, and actually that Pope Gregory he suggested because you know the Easter, the Christian people that there is a religion religious day called Easter. Easter we actually celebrate the after the first moon after 31st of March, means the after vernal equinox point, the first moon day is called the Easter day. But in 1582, Pope Gregory 13, when he observed that the dates were something goes wrong with that calendar because that intercalation was not taken care of, means that now we call it leap year, it was not taken care of. So the Easter date actually it should be somewhere after 31st of March, 21st of March, 11 days after that 21st of March, but it does not happen like this. So they come to a conclusion that we have to introduce more days with the calendar so that we can adjust all these days. And they found actually on 1582, year 1582, on Thursday it was 4th of October, and on Friday it should be 5th of October instead of that, according to the Julian calendar. But instead of that, if you just put 15th of October on that day, then the calendar will match with the Easter day. So they modify the calendar with the replacing the 5th of October to 15th October. So in your human civilization, in human history, you never find the dates from 5 to 14th of October in 1582. It is missing because they simply just put the 4th of October to 15th of October next day. That was done by Pope Gregory 13th, and it was actually suggested by Christopher Clavius, a Jesuit mathematician. So he suggested to Pope Gregory, and this is called the Gregorian calendar. And presently, we are following the Gregorian calendar in our day-to-day life. So now the question is our calendar really accurate or right? If you see, in a year, we consider in our calendar 365 days. Actually, it takes the sun, the earth takes 365.2429 days to revolve around the sun. So when it revolves around the sun, it takes 365.256 days, and it will be somewhere here, but we declare it a particular that the year is completed. So if you just add these 2.256 days, after 4 years, it will be almost one complete day. So we put a complete day, we replace this 28 February with 29, we call it leap year. In Indian, it is called Molama. So 29, one day more, it is called leap year. Now the problem is, you just see, in human civilization, it was the greatest mistake in our human civilization because we could not even manage a good calendar in our civilization. So that was okay for a certain period of time, but when the computer start developing, the problem came. The first thing is, how do you understand that the sun actually moves, the earth move around the sun in 365.256 days? Very simple observation. You just observe the sun on 21st of March and 23rd of September, you will find the sun rises somewhere here in particular place. Now you observe the sun on 21st of June, it will rise in the slightly in the northern direction. It is called the summer solstice. Then on 23rd of September, it will come back again to this point. And 22nd of December, it will go to the southern direction. It will rise somewhere here. Again, from 22nd of December to 21st of March, again, come back to this point. So now, it's the sun, if you just measure, it will go here, then it will come back, then it will go, then it will come back. It will take exactly to 365.265 days. So from that, you can calculate the revolution period of Earth around the sun. So if you can measure it, then you will understand that the actual length of our 1 year. Now, this is the time which is actually fixed in astronomical point of view, from the astronomical point of view. This is fixed. Now the problem is, since we could not measure the time properly, we could not measure the time, and we have to fix one particular day after 4 years, a leap year. Now when the computer comes, the computer doesn't know about the leap year and all these things. So we have to put a program to understand that there is a leap year and we have to add one more day. So the computer will understand and it will go according to the software. Now when we measure up to the fraction of second while you are using mobile phone and all these things to communicate, we actually transfer our data in gigabyte data and all these things in fraction of second. So in that case, we have to measure fraction of a second, which is called leap second, and even the leap fraction of second, leap year, leap month, leap second, like this. So while using this leap second, you have to do lot of calculations, lot of software you have to develop, and we spend a lot of money out of it and a lot of human effort. So this is a greatest blunder in our human civilization. Anyway, come to the concept of time again. The philosophy of time, it says that there are two concepts of time developed later on. One is called Newtonian time, because Newton believed that the fundamental structure of the universe, a dimension independent of the event, and it occurs everywhere in the same way. And there is no any relation between the space and the time or reference. So in Newtonian concept, it's called the Newtonian concept of time. And in the other side, there is the Gottfried Leibniz and the Immanuel Kant. They call that time is neither an event nor a thing, and thus is not itself measurable, nor can it be traveled. So their concept is different from the Newtonian concept of time. It was developed in the 15th century. Now, if you see the physical definition of time with Newton and Einstein, Newton said the time passes uniformly without regard to whether anything happened in the world, actually in the universe itself. So there is no any relation between the anything happened in the world with time. In other side, Einstein, when he developed the special theory of relativity, general theory of relativity, even the special theory of relativity as well, he said that time depends on the special reference frame of the observer. So the time is dependent with the frame of reference, but for the Newton, it is not the time is not dependent on the frame of reference of the observer. So there are two different school of thoughts you can see in modern time. So now for the few people, those who are not from the physics background or the mathematics background, just let me tell you about the general theory of relativity. The concept of that relativity is very simply, if you look at the sky, we see a lot of stars in the sky. Just take an example of the Ursa Major. There are seven stars. This Ursa Major, it looks like a spoon, like this. The spoon shape during the summer, we'll see in the northern sky. Now, actually, these stars are not in the same the distance. These stars are actually lies at a different distance like this. So the first, this star is almost 165 light years distance from us. And this star, second star, is almost 85 light years distance from us. Similarly, these stars are at a different distances. Now, when you look at the sky, you look at the sky, where the stars are located at different distances, means when they releases the light, it travels, it takes 165 years to reach the observer, and this star, it takes 85 years to reach to the observer. So when you look at the sky, actually we are looking at different time. You are looking at different time, and represented by different star at different time, the different event happening in the different time, but these stars are actually occupying a space in the universe. So there is a relation between space and the time. So this is what about, very simply, this is what about the relativity, the general theory of relativity, you can say. So if you see the sky, it is like, you know, it is time machine. So this is a very simple concept. I'm just explaining to the non-physics, non-mathematics background people. Now, about the time, I'm not a biologist, so I cannot say more detail about this, but if you see them from the biology point of view, actually how our brain reacts, that is also, we can say the time frame, that we get, the concept of time. I mean, some people, the same 24 hours, some people feel that, oh, the time is very short for me to do this particular work, and some people are very relaxed. So why some people are very relaxed within a certain frame of time, and some people are very much anxious about, and very much they feel that the time is running out of that, so he has to do, or she has to do the work within that time frame. So time is running fast for some people, and for some people time is going slow. It depends on the cerebral cortex. So time can also be referred in terms of biology. I'm not going into detail about it. Now, you know that the timekeeping devices, the study of timekeeping devices, is called horology. And this horology came from the word horos, the horo, the hora, and the hour also come from that. So to make it short, I'm not going into discuss about that horology or the timekeeping devices. There are several devices. In ancient time, people used to understand the year start with the Sirius, a particular star. When it rises, people come to know that there will be a flood in the Nile River. Then the periodic succession of night and day, people try to understand the time. Then first appearance of sun at the horizon, people try to understand the time. Then mid position of the sun, they try to understand the sky, like this. Now, these are some ancient timekeeping devices. I'm not going into it. So, when up to 17th century, even 16th century, 17th century, people didn't realize about the concept of time at different zones, because people did not travel much. But when the people start traveling through sea or the ocean with big ships and in the ocean, they reach one place to the other place very easily and with a very short period of time. Then they start realizing that time of a particular place is different, local time, means local time of a particular place is different from the other place. So they start realizing that the time, the differences of time at different places over the world, at different places, because the whole earth is round. Now the worldwide time zone, the time of different places is different. That concept actually first introduced by Quirico Philopanti. I do not know how to pronounce it. Philopant, that one. But no one accepted unless the star Stanford Fleming, he proposed the worldwide system time zone in 1879. So in 1879 only, the people start taking the concept of the worldwide time. Means the time is different for different places in the world. If you just consider in reference to the universal time, so the time, local time at different places are different. This is called the worldwide time zone. You can consider zone wise at different time. So this is one. But this is not the first time they develop. Actually, in Eratosthenes, he was from 276 BC to 195 BC. He first gave the idea about the concept of the zonal time, and he developed the map also. And the Claudius Ptolemy also developed similar kind of concept during his time. So that was the concept developed from the ancient civilization as well. Now, later on, the international time zone were fixed because in the meantime, the Greenwich, you know, that the Greenwich Observatory was set in UK, and from the 1st of November, it was started the international time zone, where it was considered that when the sun passes through the mid, means at the top, it's at the zenith, it is called the noon, and from that noon, we'll consider the time. If it is the all the other places are towards the east, the time will be positive, and if it is in the west, the time will be negative. Means if the noon, it is noon at Greenwich Observatory, then in the eastern side, it will be now going ahead of the time, means it will be afternoon, and in the southern direction, it is forenoon. So this is the concept developed, and it was followed. Greenwich Mean Time means the time started from the Greenwich Observatory when the sun passes during the daytime, the noon, or in the through the zenith. So that is the Greenwich Mean Time started from 1st of November. It was introduced like international time zone. Now the problem is, if you just consider Greenwich somewhere here Greenwich. So if you just consider Greenwich Mean Time. So you have to take a line like this. You have to consider this line to understand the time for the international time zone. You have to take it as a reference. And this time it is positive. This time it is negative. Means it is afternoon. It is forenoon. Now, if you just consider it, then there is a problem. People saw when the people observed that the sun actually doesn't pass exactly at noon to the zenith, means exactly top of your head in the sky. So moon passes through, sometimes it goes slow, sometimes it goes fast. Only during this time, April here, then this time, and this 4 days only, the sun passes through the zenith exactly at noon. And other day, sun sometimes passes slightly after the actual noon, and sometimes it passes before the noon. So you cannot take this line exactly for reference of your time. So for that, people start taking another concept of reference time. It's called the universal, the coordinated universal time. It was considered here. If you see the map, it is considered like this. If you just consider this UTC, then you can start the time from here. This is another date. Say today is 28th of July. Suppose this is 28th of July now we are enjoying. Here it is 27th of July. So it is 27th of July. After crossing it, actually this part is this part. Now after crossing it, one day will go. So in this line, one side is, sorry, this part is they say 27th of July, this part will be 28th of July, like this. So if you just consider this line here, it is easy because there is no any other countries, the countries are avoided. But if you just take this line as a universal time, then in certain countries, if you see this Africa and some other countries, they in particular day, this will be the another date, this will be another day. So one country have to enjoy two different dates in a particular day. So to avoid all this, people start taking this as a the UTC, coordinated universal timeline, and consider it universal, and people start taking time from here. Now while taking this time, now generally in when we discuss about the time, we say that 3 p.m. 3 a.m. After 12 o'clock, we say p.m. Before 1 o'clock, 12 o'clock in the noon, we call a.m. That concept will not be considered. We cannot consider a.m. and p.m. Now, when you consider this universal timeline, we have to go from hour 1 to hour 24. So when you say 1 hour, 2 hour, you have to say 12 hour, 13 hour, 14 hour instead of a.m. and p.m. This is the correct correct information about the time you are going to record in your different observations at different different data collections and your day-to-day life. So we cannot actually, we should not say a.m. and p.m. while considering UTC. Instead of a.m. and p.m., we have to go from 1 hour to 24 hour like this. Now, that coordinated system, the coordinated universal time system, it was started in 1st of January 1916, but which has a certain modification, it was actually implemented in 1972, and it is now we are following that universal coordinated universal time. It is called UTC. In India, we call it Indian Standard Time, and it was fixed with that 82.5 the timeline with 82.5 east line. From here, we consider it. So this is the east and this is the west. We consider the time according to that. Now, interestingly, while taking this time zone, again, there are certain, because you know that the day length is different for different season. So to reduce the energy to work during the daytime, some of the countries, they start a particular very interesting point is called the daylight saving. Daylight saving means work hour they change with duration of time. Say is 6 morning 6 a.m. which we call a.m. So morning 6 hour is slightly they shifted to 1 hour before. Means the when we say 5 hour or for your common word say 5 a.m. they call it 6 a.m. so that we can start our office at 6 a.m. and we can get a maximum length of time for work to save the power, not to work at night. But if you see, the most of the countries in the Western, which is very rich, they follow the that particular concept to save the day, your energy during to work at day. The daytime saving, and the most of the poor countries who do not follow the rates are the countries they do not follow the daylight saving. So this is really a very interesting point. We do not follow with the poor country do not follow the daylight saving, but the rich country they follow the daylight saving. We'll have to work at night to spend a lot of energy. So the Kolsky still come later on to understand. Then finally, the atomic clock, it was actually developed developed by Lord Kelvin in 1879, and the first accurate atomic calendar the clock was developed using the cesium 133 atom. It is developed by Louis Eschen and in National Physical Laboratory of UK. And the first atomic clock was developed to measure the exact value of a fraction of a second. So what is that atomic clock? To measure the fraction of a second, the atomic clock was developed using cesium 133 atom, which is a radioactive atom. Now in the cesium atom, if you see, there is a radiation takes place from the cesium atom, and that the frequency of that radiation is 91926317700 hertz. So that much of frequency it radiates every time, and that frequency doesn't change for millions of years. So that from that radiation, you can calculate the fraction of a second very accurately, and that fraction of second lasted for several million of years, so that we can calculate a fraction of second, very, very accurate. So the cesium 133 atom is at temperature 0 degree Kelvin is taken for measuring the fraction of second, and which is called atomic clock. Now, even the fraction of second, though it is a fixed time, it is also not fixed. Why it is not fixed? Because the Earth, when it rotates around its own axis, it doesn't rotate. It sometimes it goes slow because of the tidal effect. Because the water is there, so the shape of the water become like this oval shape, and when the oval shape rotates with a solid body, there is a frictional force between the surface and the solid body and the liquid body. So the Earth rotation becomes slow down, and sometimes it goes slow. That is why even the atomic clock cannot measure the actual length of a year or the clock system. So that is why, in from the ephemeric second, means when you measure from the rotation of the Earth around its own axis from time to time, and when you observe the Earth rotate around the Sun in a year, and you divide it into fraction into second, it will come with 31556925.9747, that much of second. So from time to time you have to measure the second in a particular year, and you have to observe the atomic clock, and you have to adjust the atomic clock according to the ephemeric second. Then only you will get a very accurate result of a particular fraction of second. Now somebody can ask, why do you need a fraction of second to measure? See, now presently we are using the mobile phone computer, where we are transferring data in gigabyte. Means gigabyte means a particular 1 second we are transferring gigabyte of data in a 1 second, means that much of fraction of second we have to calculate very accurately. That is why even the fraction of second is equally important. So even the second is elastic, so we have to measure with ephemeric, means we have to ultimately rely on the astronomical data, which is that can be found by observing the exact rotation of the Earth around the Sun and exact rotation of the Earth around its own axis. Now, if I just consider that, what is the smallest unit of time we can measure then? So if I consider this time, what is the smallest time we can measure? The smallest time is 5.39 into 10 to the power minus 44 seconds. That is the smallest time we can measure, which is called Planck time. So very simply, if you just say the Planck time, what is Planck time? It is the time, the Planck length means, for the layman, just let me tell you what is Planck length. Just take two fundamental particle and let this fundamental particle be collided with each other. When they come to closer to each other, that much of length or the size of the fundamental particle may be, is a layman language, almost similar to the Planck length. Now the light takes to travel from one point to the half part of that, the radius of this will be considered as the time, the Planck time. So the minimum measurable time is 5.939 into 10 to the power minus 44 seconds. This is the Planck time we can measure. So from that we can say life and time are the two best teachers. Life teaches us to make good use of time, and time teaches us the value of life. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your beautiful talk. Now, there are some queries for you, sir.
Yeah, please. খুব ভাল প্রশ্ন বিগ ব্যাং যেটু আমি আমি মহানাদ এতিয়া বিজ্ঞানীবিলাকে কয় যে মহানাদৰ লগে সময়ৰো আৰম্ভ হল কিন্তু এই প্ৰশ্নটো এটা ডাঙৰ প্ৰশ্ন যে মহানাদৰ আগতে কি আছিলে বা সময় নাছিলে নে কি আছিলে সেই কথাটো উত্তৰ পাবলৈ আমি এতিয়াও বহুত বাকী আছে, কাৰণ এতিয়া লাহে লাহে কথাটো এনেকুৱা হৈছে যে মহানাদ আমি জানো যে বিগ বেং এটা ইভেণ্ট বুলি আমি ভাবিছিলোঁ, কিন্তু এতিয়া মহাকাশত কিছুমান এনেকুৱা জ্যোতিষ্ক আৱিষ্কাৰ হৈছে যে যিবিলাকৰ দূৰত্ব মোৰ দেন 13.7 বিলিয়ন লাইট ইয়াৰ্ছ, তাৰমানে সেইবিলাক বিগ বেঙৰ আগৰ হ'ব লাগিব বা কিবা তেনেকুৱা ধৰণৰ হ'ব লাগিব। গতিকে যদি সেইটোৱে হয় বিগ বেং তাৰমানে এটা নহয়, এতিয়া মাল্টি ইউনিভাৰ্ছ তাৰমানে বহু কেইখন ইউনিভাৰ্ছৰ কথা ভবা হৈছে, য'ত এখন ইউনিভাৰ্ছ হয়তো মানে তাৰ পৰা মেটেৰিয়েল আহি এইখন ইউনিভাৰ্ছ আৰম্ভ হৈছে বা মাল্টি ইউনিভাৰ্ছ বেলেগ বেলেগ আৰম্ভ হৈছে তেনেকুৱা ধৰণৰ। গতিকে এক্সেক্টলি বিগ বেঙৰ সময়তে টাইম আৰম্ভ হৈছে এই কনচেপ্টটো লাহে লাহে এতিয়া আঁতৰি যাব ধৰিছে, কিন্তু বিগ বেঙৰ আগত কি আছিল সেই কথাটো জানিবলৈ এতিয়াও আমি বহুত বাকী আছে। এইখিনি মইতো ক'ব নোৱাৰোৱে, এতিয়াও আমি আমাৰ মানে ক'ব পৰা অৱস্থাত কোনেও অহাই নাই।
What are the limitations of time? Is it possible to have a seven-dimensional space time coordinate?
Just let me tell you, I am not from that field, but some of our participant, I know one Professor Bhim Prasad Sharma, then Manjil Hazarika, they are very good in this field. But just let me tell you, if you just take the general theory of relativity, we can discuss in terms of some other coordinates, means I cannot say at this moment here. So you have to take not in the four dimension, more than four dimension people just are thinking about. So in that term you can say the time is maybe more dimensional, but if you just say dimension, time is only single dimension. But if you see the Minkowski space, the participant who has asked this question, is he from physics background?
Yes, maybe.
If he is from physics background, probably he knows about the Minkowski space. In Minkowski space, you will see that the time timeline you can deviate timeline from one direction to the other direction. So in that sense, we can say multi-dimension, but otherwise it's very difficult to say that seven dimension or eight dimension or more than four dimension. It is very difficult to say. It's a different school of thoughts by different people.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Then in Julian calendar, sir,
yeah,
why 5 October and 14 October are missing day?
Yeah, already I told that if you just just go on taking the Julian calendar, then in that calendar there is no any leap year. Means every 4 years of duration we introduce one more day, because actually the length of the year is not 365 days, but it's slightly more than 365 days. And if you just add up, after 4 years, it will complete one particular day, and we have to add it. Now, in Julian calendar, it was not considered. So that leap year was missing in Julian calendar. So if you just go on doing like this, taking the Julian calendar, then every 4 years, there will be one day missing from the calendar, and it will go like this. But when the Gregory in 59, I just consider the Julian calendar, then the star date will not fall exactly when it should fall. So that is why he recalculated and found that we have to reduce few days from the calendar, and every time we have to reduce few numbers of hours from the calendar, then only it will be accurate. So that is why the Gregorian calendar he introduced with reducing number of dates from 5 to 14, means that days 15 days he reduce it.
Okay,
yes, got the answer. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Another one, sir.
Yeah, please.
If we look before 13.7 light years away,
yeah,
in the night sky,
yeah,
do we actually see the Big Bang?
There are certain limitations which is called we have human limitations. We cannot see up to that. the boundary up to 13.7. Then I cannot directly. There is another topic I have to start with. So there is a horizon up to which we can see. There is a limitation of 50, that limitation we cannot cross, because when the universe is expanding, when it was started, it has not started, and now it is reaching to our place. So we cannot go with 13.7 directly, but with very strong telescope and some of the particular star, which is not a common star, we can go up to probably 13.7 billion light years, and slightly even more now. But presently, this is not possible.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
With present technology.
And explain the relation between twin paradox and time dilation. Question from physics, actually.
Okay. Probably he knows about the time dilation, that he related to the T naught root over 1 minus V square by C square. When V is reaching to C, then the time becomes slow. Then at V equal to C, time will be zero. So probably he knows about the equations. That is why he asked the question. Now, time dilation means when a body moves at a higher speed, relativistic speed, then the time goes slow. Relative to the observer's time, and but for him it is okay, but from the reference to the observer, the time goes slow, which is called the time dilation.
Okay, sir.
So this question, actually we required a blackboard and a chalk so that
we can describe properly.
Verbally it is very difficult to explain.
Then, sir, there is another question. Can you tell how the atomic clock works? I mean the parts of the clock.
Yeah, actually the cesium-133 is a radioactive element. When the electron jumps from one particular energy state to the another energy state, they release energy at that particular frequency, and that frequency is measured with certain detectors. And with that frequency, we know that the frequency and the time, it is just vice versa, means frequency is nothing but amount of wave passes to a particular point in a particular time. This is frequency. So if you can measure the frequency, we can measure the time. So from that, that clock has that. This is a concept of the atomic clock.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Then, sir, one more.
Yeah.
What ties time to our nature as persons to our subjectivity?
So, I didn't get the question properly. Can you just repeat the question again?
What ties time to our nature as persons to our subjectivity? Most probably the question is not clear, sir.
I do not know what he want or she want to understand.
Yes, sir.
No.
We can skip this, sir.
Yeah?
We can skip this, sir. Then the next question is, sir, the thermodynamic error of time says time is asymmetric, whereas as quantum error of time says time is symmetric. Why is as a contradiction between the two fundamental laws of our universe?
Sorry, that I cannot answer, because it is a concept and it's a school of thought. So two different school of thought, they can explain time differently. So that I cannot say why they explain differently. It is their ideas.
Yes,
anybody can give some idea with different frame of reference, different activities like this. So it is depends on the person. It varies from person to person how you can explain it.
Yes, sir.
So that I cannot answer properly, because it that depends on the person to person and the school of thoughts.
Why time is unidirectional? Why just it flows in one direction? why time is unidirectional, why just it flows in one direction?
Actually, if you just consider from the relativity theory, time is not unidirectional. In one direction, you can say it is you are moving towards the past. In one direction, you can say you are moving towards the future. Suppose you are standing somewhere and you are looking at the sky, and you are observing a star which is radiating energy from the eastern horizon. Now the star is radiating energy and it is passes through you and it is passing through the western horizon. Now if I look at the particular light in the western horizon, what I am looking at? In the eastern horizon, we are looking at the past, and the western horizon, I am looking at the future. So it is not that time is one-directional, it is unidirectional.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Then, what is quantum error of time?
Again, someone is asking. This is depends on the person to person. I have no idea about, because I have not gone too much about it. So I cannot say at this moment.
Yes, sir. Are there any mathematical expression to show that the relation between gravitational force and time dilation?
Yes, very much. There is a relation between that. There is a relation. Yes.
Then, sir,
for that explanation, I need a blackboard and the chalk.
Yes,
so that
yes.
I can
explain mathematical expression.
Yeah.
Why we cannot divide second into some number, then another one? Is really time exist?
Can you repeat that question?
Why we cannot divide second into some number, then another one? Is really time exist?
I didn't get that question properly, but yes, definitely we can divide the second into the fraction. Now, fraction of second is very much important. When you in communication system, that exists. In digital system, we divide time into different segments. I think he asked that question or something else. I'm not getting the point.
Yeah, the question is no. Yes, then, another one. Nowadays, why string theory and also M theory is in a active region in research field? Is there any possibility of time travel?
I will not discuss about the string theory at this moment because it is a totally separate subject. But about the time travel, just let me tell you that when you say consider the time travel, it is hypothetical, first of all, and secondly, actually I have seen in many books even, and many of the people, they explain about the space-time curvature, which is wrong photograph or wrong diagram. If you just consider that the space is two-dimensional, and you just consider the rubber seat, and you just put a ball, and the rubber seat will go, it will bend. That is a wrong conception, to be frank. Space is not the single rubber seat like the two-dimensional space. It is, if you just consider three-dimensional space, at least minimum three-dimensional, now you just consider that space is a rubbery object and put a ball inside it, and this is just squeeze the ball, in all direction the rubbery portion will bend. So actually the space-time curvature should like this. Now if there are two rubbery ball which is bent together, and you just try to put near to each other, I think the space-time will go away from each other every moment, and it will never meet each other. So I do not know that. So from that point of view, you can say that the time travel is actually not possible. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Can I put more questions to you, sir?
No problem.
Yes. Then does time flow in more than one direction in higher dimensions?
Yeah.
Does time flows in more than one direction in higher direction? Actually, it is similar to another question probably.
Yeah, it is similar to that already. I have answered it. I am thankful to those asking that question. I am not too expert in time about the time, but still they have asked in such a way that I am the expert of. I can answer all the questions they put about the time. Thank you very much for that.
Sir, another one. If we accept that gravity is due to the curvature of time, space time, should it also cause repulsion as it causes gravity?
First of all, you have to come out from that idea that gravity is the curvature of space time. You have to consider gravity as a gravity, space time curvature due to the massive object mass. The relation between the mass and the object like this. First, you have to consider like this. Then you come with the idea about the gravity. Then you put it. Because then you have to, that Einstein's equation you have to put later on. Then it will come. Because gravity, if you just consider from the Newtonian concept, and if you try to put it in the Einstein's equation directly, then it will not work. Then there will be a mismatch between these two ideas.
Can we put another
that
question?
That is happening with him, probably. That is happening with the person who is asking that question.
Sir, can we put another question?
Yeah, please.
Since we are seeing the past in the night sky, is it that we are seeing the stars? So why might not be present in the sky now? The stars might have exploded or moved to some other position.
I understood the point. Yes, it is very much possible. It's very much possible. Suppose there is a star which is lying at a distance of, say, 50 light years distance. And say, the 50 years ago, the star become exploded. And it is, I'll tell you one more point. Exploded, that is, now it is not available in that particular area. It is gone. But the light which is coming out from the star is still not reaching to Earth. So we can see the star up to next 50 years. So after that only, we will see that there is nothing. So this is very much possible, yes. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, sir. Sir, another one. Anubhav Datta asks, sir, does time really exist? What is real and imaginary time? Is the concept of time like day, month, year, etc. we are using real or imaginary?
Thank you. So out of that, the length of year is totally real. Means we can see that the Earth revolving around the Sun is called the length, we can say length of the year. Then the day is real, means Earth revolves around its own axis, it is real. The rest is we have divided into according to our choice, according to our convenience. This is real, but it is not exactly natural.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Then, sir, this is probably the last question. We have seen from special relativity at velocity c, the time stops. Does it means that a particle would stop interacting with Higgs mechanism and become massless? Is this the reason why photon is massless?
That directly I cannot say like this. So there are, can you repeat the question again? I missed some
point. Yes, sir. We have seen from special relativity at velocity c, the time stops. Does it means that a particle would stop interacting with Higgs mechanism and become massless? Is this the reason why photon is massless?
No. I am not expert in Higgs mechanism and all these things, but what with my understanding, That is another concept with quantum mechanics. You have to go through with that. But here it is not quantum mechanics. It follows the simple time dilation rules, that t equal to t naught root over 1 minus b square by c square. But what about the Higgs mechanism? It is not exactly related to that. It is a quantum mechanics problem. Somebody can relate later on, but directly you cannot relate that relativistic mechanism with the quantum mechanics directly like this.
Yes, sir. Thank you. With this, we want to finish the question and answer session, sir.
Thank you, sir. Very much. Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Now, I request Mahmuda Begum from our department to give the vote of thanks. Over to Mahmuda.
A very good afternoon to everyone. I deem it a great honor to propose the vote of thanks to all who have helped us in making this webinar such a resounding success. First of all, I, on behalf of the Department of Physics, Lakhimpur Girls College, would like to propose heartfelt gratitude to our spokesperson, Dr. Kishore Borua, sir, for gracing today's webinar. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation for the webinar as a research person. I take the opportunity to extend our sincere and hearty vote of thanks to Dr. Borua sir for making excellent presentation, sharing your valuable time with us, and making this webinar very interesting and meaningful. Hope the participants are very much benefited by your presentation.
Thank you.
I would like to express our profound gratitude to our respected principal sir, Dr. Surajit Bhuya, for his constant inspiration, guidance, and support in organizing the webinar. I would also like to thank our esteemed participants, without whose active participation, the webinar would have not been a successful one. Finally, I would like to express our heartfelt thanks to the entire team, especially to Dr. Parama Dutta and Babishan Terang, and all those who are directly or indirectly associated in organizing the webinar, without whose helping hand this event would have not been a possible one. Once again, I thank all for your cordial cooperation. Thank you. Now, I would like to request our HOD, Madam Vinita Hazarika, to wind up the session.
With this, sir, we want to wind up the session here, sir. And thank you very much, sir, for your beautiful presentation and explanation. Thank you again, sir.
Thank you very much.